فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون
نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته قال تعالى فاقصص القصص لعلهم يتفكرون Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to narrate the stories so that we may reflect upon it. Stories are told to learn lessons from. And this is why almost a third of the Quran is stories. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala conveys to us so many messages through stories. And this afternoon, inshallah, in 58 minutes, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, that is the time I was given, I will share with you the story of Salman, radiallahu anhu. One of the highest ranks Salman, radiallahu anhu, attained is a statement made by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said about him, Salman minna ahl al-bayt aw ahl al-bayt. Salman is from my family. Imagine. And inshallah, we will come towards the end of the story of Salman to the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made that statement. I really would like to convey a message or the essence of the story today through the story of Salman. One message that I want you to go home with, that the only true religion to be followed at this time is La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. There is no other religion. قال تعالى إن الدين عند الله الإسلام. The religion with Allah سبحانه وتعالى is Islam. قال تعالى ومن يبتغي غير الإسلام دينا فلن يقبل منه وهو في الآخرة من الخاسرين. Whosoever seeks another religion other than Islam, it will not be accepted from him and he will be amongst the losers in the day of resurrection. في صحيح الإمام مسلم حديث معقل ابن يسار عفوا حديث عياض ابن حمار المجاشعي رضي الله عنه حديث قدسي The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nazara ila ahli al-ardi famaqatahum arabahum wa ajamahum illa baqaya min ahli al-kitab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looked at the people in earth and he resented them. المقت, الكره, he disliked them. He did not like them. Whether they are Arabs or whether they are non-Arabs, except few from the people of the book. The question here, when did this looking take place? The scholars, they say, right before the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right before the sending of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In this hadith ilahi, hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala broke the people in earth into three categories. What is number one? Come on, help me here. What? Arabs, two? Non-Arabs, three?
The people of the book.
The people of the book. Let's begin with the Arabs. What did the Arabs used to worship right before the sending of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The Arabs, from the time of Ismail and Ibrahim, they are a follower of this millah. So they are supposed to follow the millah of Ibrahim and Ismail and follow their sharia, their teachings. And by the way, they kept doing this until a man from the Arabia whose name is Amr ibn Luhay al-Khuzai. He was very famous to be very eloquent to the extent that they said that he receives revelation from jinn. He has a jinni. Very eloquent, very influential. He went to Sham. Now pay attention because these terms, we're going to need it when you narrate the story of Salman. What is Sham? Sham, we don't say Syria, we say the greater Syria. Why? Because at this time, Sham was what? Lebanon, Jordan, Palestine, and Syria. Those four. When we say Sham, that means what? That's why we use the term what? The greater Syria. Right now, the Brits, when they came, and the French, when they came to the Muslim world, what did they do, Sykes-Picot? What did they do? They broke us into small little places, and we're fighting one another now. So, he went to Sham, and the people used to worship idols there. He used to worship idols. He liked the idea. He actually carried idols back to him, back with him to Mecca. He brought idols back to Mecca. في صحيح الإمام البخاري, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, الحديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه, he said, رأيت, I saw عم ابن لحي الخزاعي, I saw him in hell the night of المعراج, the night of the ascension, يجر قصبه في النار, dragging his intestines in hell. Why? Look. فإنه كان أول من بدل دين إبراهيم. He was the first one who misguided the people to change the religion of Ibrahim. Because from that time on, since he brought these idols to Mecca, he started preaching that new religion, the people gradually started worshipping idols. In another wording, أول من سيب السوائب, to the extent that the people started saying this animal is for this lamb, this animal is for that al-Uzza, even rituals, he introduced rituals. But the question here, did all the Arabs follow him? Yes, except few. We'll take, for example, the father of Sa'id ibn Zayd ibn Rufayl, ibn Amr ibn Rufayl. What is the name? What is the name of this companion? Sa'id ibn Zayd ibn Amr ibn Rufayl. He is one of the 10 people who is giving the tithing of Jannah. His father, by the way, never changed his millah. Asma radiallahu anha used to say, well, Hadith al-Bukhari also, I saw him, he actually died before the prophethood of the Prophet with a huge beard, sitting and having his back to the Kaaba, and he's telling, Ya ma'ashara Quraysh, O people of Quraysh, Wallahi ma asbaha ahadun ala millati Ibrahim bayni. I'm the only one in the way of Ibrahim. And he followed the millah of Ibrahim. He was so proud of it. وَكَانَ يُوْقِدُ الْمَوْقُودَ When he sees somebody who will go and bury his daughter alive, he will go, don't do it, bring her to me. I'll take care of her for you. And after he grows her up, brings her up, he, okay, take her back. زيد بن عمرو ولذلك عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما وسعيد they came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال because why ابن عمر because ابن عمر and سعيد are cousins زيد بن عمرو بن نفيل is the brother of the Khattab the father of عمر and the father of عمر used to punish him used to beat him up for being حنيف على ملة إبراهيم يعني So they came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and they said, Ya Rasulullah, أَنَسْتَغْفِرُ لِزَيْدٍ Should we ask Allah to forgive Zayd? قال نعم, yes, إِنَّهُ يُبْعَثُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أُمَّةً وَحْدًا Imagine this. He will be raised up in the day of resurrection, a nation by himself. Why? Because he reached the truth in the depth of darkness. The point I'm trying to make that not all the Arabs followed عمرو بن لحي رسولنا our messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم never what he never prostrated to an idol never worshipped an idol أبو بكر الصديق عثمان بن عفان أبو ذر الغفاري we have few companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم who never worshipped idols they stayed on the millah of إبراهيم عليه الصلاة والسلام ف this is once it comes to the Arabs طيب next أهل الكتاب that's the next Salman is going to give us an indication with the non-Arabs. What was happening with the non-Arabs. And that's why we leave the non-Arabs till the end. What about Ahlul Kitab? When we say Ahlul Kitab, what do we mean by that? Come on. Jews and Christians. But Jews, by rejecting the message of Prophet Isa, they already got out of the fold of Islam. And actually taking an attempt on his life, kafaru khalas. They did not believe in the Messenger of Isa alayhi salam. They accused his mother of adultery. وَالْعَيَادُ بِاللَّهِ وَبِكُفْرِهِمْ وَقَوْلِهِمْ عَلَى مَرْيَمَ بُهْتَانًا عَظِيمًا They claimed that they killed Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. But وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ وَلَكِنْ شُبِّهَ لَهُ So Jews are already what? Resented already because they are kuffar. طب what about Christians? Look at Athar ibn Abbas. Sa'id ibn Jubayr narrated from Ibn Abbas. The Christians divided into three groups right after Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. One group is called Al-Ya'qubiyyah, the Jacobites. I mean, these are the names that they adopted. What did they say? قالوا, they said, كان الله فينا. Allah came down into earth with us. Then we killed him for our sins. Yes, salam. Interesting. So Allah came down from his throne, Al-Lahut, got into Nasud, the human flesh. Imagine this, got into Nasud, and then he allowed the people to put him to the cross. For what? For our sins, because we're sinners. Yes, salam. Look at this. You know, we have a verse in the Quran, أَفَرَأَيْتَ مِنْ اتَّخَدَ إِلَهَا Have you ever looked at somebody who uses his God as what? As his, like the guy who makes an idol. You know how he makes an idol? Okay, I want my God to be really handsome. I want him to be smiling, you know. That kind of thing, you know, exactly. Like you play with the God the way that... So this is Ya'qubiyyah. طيب. The second group is called النُسْتُورِيَّة. The Nusturites, I'm reading, my translation could be, I'm reading, you know, I'm quoting Arabic. The Nusturites and Nusturiyya. What did Nusturiyya say? قالوا, they said, كان ابن الله فينا. Allah brought down his son into earth and he sacrificed his son for our sins. Here's the third group. What did they say? قال كان عيسى. ابن مريم رسول الله فينا ثم رفع إلى السماء وسينزل قبل قيام الساعة Amongst us was Isa the son of Maryam the messenger of Allah and he was raised up to Allah and Allah shall bring him down as a sign of the hour مش ده لا إله إلا الله ولا لا This is La ilaha illallah, Isa Rasulullah. This is Tawheed. When you hear, why I'm saying all of this? Because Salman is going to go through these guys who believe that. You understand? Salman is going to go through individuals who, listen, you have to go to that person. Don't go to that person. You have to go to that person. That I need this to narrate the story of Salman for you. You need to understand this. Now, look at this now. The first two groups united with the authority, with the government, against what? The third group. Some of them were put to death for making da'wah, just making da'wah. Some of them actually were burned on the cross. They put them on the cross, crucified them. And the others did what? They decided to go to the desert and build sanctuaries and isolate themselves from the people. Who knows the story of Juraij? Juraij. Did you hear the story of Juraij before? Yeah. Brothers, you don't know the story of Juraij? Juraij al-Abid. Salaamu alaykum. ما سمعت story of Juraij قبل هذا؟ الله أكبر. You know, Juraij هذا used to worship Allah in the sanctuary. وبعدين بني إسرائيل did not like how he is pious and righteous. Remember the two groups? Huh? They said, let's get this guy down, man. This guy is so righteous. This guy is so good. Of course, yeah, I'm really narrating it in my own language here. Huh? The Prophet did not speak like that. So they said, the best way to bring a man down is a woman. And it always does. Be careful. Watch it. Women will always get you. And this is a sign of strength for the sisters, by the way. No offense. So we have sisters out there and we don't want to upset our sisters. Huh? So she went and she stood by his sanctuary. Subhanallah, he had a very sanctuary. You see that second floor, how it's done? He had a sanctuary like this. He would it on the top of a tree, and whenever he wants to come down, he used to have a rope, so he would climb down, and then he would climb up because he wanted to separate himself from the people. But this woman came and stood by his sanctuary, he did not even give her attention. So she slept with the shepherd. She became pregnant, and she said, Juraij is the one who did it. She accused him of adultery after she delivered the baby. So the people came, Enzil ya Murali, come down, Mr. Showy off, Mr. Righteous, come down. You know, Enzil ya Fajr, come down, O wicked. You see, one of the worst signs in a community that the people take down the icons. You know, the people who are known to be righteous and pious. That's why he killed him. He came down, and he's, of course, the whole thing happened because of the supplication of his mother. I'd love to narrate that story in a different lecture, but I'm just trying to show you that some of these people were righteous and pious. So in any rate, he said, can you please allow me to pray two rak'ahs? He prayed two rak'ahs, and he hit the infant in his side. And he asked him, who's your father? He said, the shepherd. But now, Hadi Karam, this is Karam. But Juraij Hada is a follower of Isa. He is from the third group. But he withdrew from what? From the society. You know another story that shows you this? The boy of the king. You know the story of the boy of the king, right?
Yes.
You don't know the story of the boy of the king?
Subhanallah,
the boy of the king, the boy of the king. You haven't seen it? Ya Allah, what's going on in Chicago, ya ikhwan? Fayn al-ilm? Huh? The boy is walking to learn sorcery, and he hears what? Somebody is reciting the revelation in secret. Who are you? Well, I'm here, I'm in the hideout, because if the king finds out, he's going to kill me. So this is what? This is Bani Israel. That is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looked at the people in earth and he resented all of them, whether they are Arabs, non-Arabs, except few from the people of the book. Because now don't assume few who say Father, Son, Holy Ghost. No, the few who are what? The true followers of who? Of the message of Prophet Isa. And those are the people who will help Salman to reach the truth. Okay? Now let's come to the non-Arabs. The non-Arabs, the ideal here, Salman. Salman used to live in a place called Asfahan. Asfahan is known today to be what?
Iran.
Huh? What?
Iran.
The country Iran now. And he used to live in a city called Al-Madain and a village called Jin. That is where he used to live. And his father used to be the Dahqan. Dahqan in Persian means the mayor of the town. And he was Qayyim al-Nar. He was given the responsibility of making sure that the fire doesn't die, because they used to worship what? Ashuf tells you that they used to worship what? Here's saying fire, cows, donkeys. Imagine you worship the created. And imagine you make sure, look at the job of Salman. Salman was so devoted that his job was to make sure that this fire doesn't die. The God doesn't die. Make sure that the God stays what?
Alive.
SubhanAllah. You make sure that the God stays alive. The people who worship, there's a Bedouin, the Arabs. They made an idol and called it Al-Uzza. You know what Al-Uzza means in Arabic? The mighty one, from Ismullah Al-Aziz. Al-Uzza derived from what? Al-Aziz. You know what Al-Aziz means? Alladhi la yuhlan. That you cannot beat me, you cannot defeat me. Aziz. So an idol called Al-Uzza, Al-Aziz, and they called Bedouin, come here. We want you to guard this God. Guard the God. This is a true story. So the Bedouin is sitting down and he's been sitting for a while, and the people would bring qurbani to the God, milk, meat. As he's sitting down, a slumber of asleep kind of took him. So he slept like this. And he opened his eyes and he saw a fox drinking the milk of Al-Uzza. And after he drank the milk, he urinated in the head of the God. He beat. Wallahi, look at the Bedouin, what is it? A Rabbun yahoolu thu'lubanu b'raqsihi qad dhalla man balat ala raqsihi fa'alim. Raqsha wa ba'adu mashi. A God that the fox urinates in his head, and the name of the God Al-Aziz, this is a humiliated one, and he left. Wallahi, I'm not going to guard that God. Look at Salman. Salman is what? Trying to keep the God they worship what? And he was devoted. ولذلك يا إخوة سبحان الله, something that is so amazing. You know that the highest rate of Christians accepting Islam in America, in which states? Do you know where? In the Bible Belt states. Not in these atheists. Not in California. In the Bible Belt. The people who grew up really to be Christians. You know, when you grow up with a religion, that is good. There is a chance for you to find the truth. But one day Salman, his father was so busy with taking care of the affairs of the city and the people. So he decided to go and wander around the land of his father. For as he was walking, he heard a beautiful recitation coming out of a building. It is the sons. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Prophet Dawood a book called what? Az-Zabur. وَآتَيْنَا دَاوُودَ زَبُورٌ. Pay attention to this. The Torah is a book of law. When you read the Torah, you know, you don't really, because you're reading laws. But the Zabur is a book where you can purify your voice with. That's why they call it song. No laws there, just songs. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave it to Prophet Dawood. Why? Because he had what?
Beautiful voice.
Imagine when he used to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the birds and the mountains used to revere after him. Echo his recitation. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he heard at one time Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu recited in the Quran, he said to him, لَقَدْ أُوتِيتَ مِزْمَارًا مِنْ مَزَامِيرِ آلِ دَاوُودِ. You are given mizmar an instrument of the instrument of Ala Dawood. Why I'm saying this, ya ikhwa? Because our youth right now, they left the Quran, huh? And they went to Justin Bieber. Ya Quran. If you want to purify your voice in Quran, what happened to the Quran? You leave هذا. والرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم tells us, من لم يتغنى بالقرآن فليس منا. Whoever does not purify his voice with the Quran is not one of us. Look, subhanAllah, when the split is Zabur was meant to recite it beautifully. And the Torah is a book of law. SubhanAllah, the Quran combined the two together. When you recite the Quran, look at this. I'm going to recite a few verses right now. Wallahi, if you translate them, top of the line, law of inheritance. This is the law of inheritance in here. يُوصِيكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي أَوْلَادِكُمْ لِلذَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ فَإِن كُنَّ نِسَاءً فَوْقَ اثْنَتَيْنِ فَلَهُنَّ ثُلُثَا مَا تَرَكَ وَإِن كَانَتْ وَاحِدَةً فَلَهَا النِّصْفُ. Actually, if you translate that stuff, man, this is difficult law. But look how it sounds. Quran, how it sounds. He became attracted to that voice. Again, he is comparing this with that. So he went inside the church and he asked them, what are you guys doing here? They said, we are Christians and we're here to teach the people Christianity. They are missionary. Like that's what they are doing in the Muslim world now. They go out there and they offer these free facilities, hospitals, and who did this? Jesus. Jesus did this for you. And a lot of people. We're so happy here that a lot of people are accepting Islam, but they are hitting us in the back there. They are doing a job in the back there. They are the missionary. They have a huge budget. I don't know if you're aware of this or not. The Vatican, the budget of the Vatican is more than Africa. The Da'wah. But in spite of this, subhanAllah, they tell you that the year 2070, Islam will be the largest religion in the face of this earth. The Vatican themselves, they know Islam is the fastest growing religion in the face of this earth. Allah is doing it. We still try to collect people together, get people together. Salman insisted that I want to go to the source of that religion. Can you please take me? Please take me to the place where this religion started. Huh? That is why a lot of our youth now, when they want to learn Islam, where are they going to go? They will go to Medina. They insisted Medina. Because Medina is where the institution, the educational institutions were set. They want to go to Medina. So Salman asked them to carry him there. He made a mistake, so when he went back home, he was so excited. So he narrated the story to his father. His father became so upset that he actually shackled him. He put him in chain. He said, you're not going out anymore. But subhanAllah, he actually managed to free himself and he joined one of these caravans and he arrived in Palestine. But look at the fitna, look at the test. His first experience, he ends up in this church with a priest who steals the people's money. Donations. I want to tell you something. Like a minute ago I said, don't go after the people who teach the deen. But the people who teach the deen also got to be very careful. You know, when you're, for example, taking the pulpit or taking a seat like this, come on, you're presenting the religion. You're gonna act like one. Your level is, ولذلك subhanAllah, look at this hadith. Usama ibn Zayd radiallahu anhu narrates, wal hadith sahih Imam al-Bukhari, the Prophet says, a man will have his intestines come out of his reed and he will go around it like a donkey goes around the grinder. ثُمَّ يَدُورُ حَوْلَهَا كَمَا يَدُورُ الْحِمَارُ فِي الرَّحْمِ. The people will come to him and say, يَا هَذَا أَوْ سُوَ سُوَ. Weren't you that sheikh who used to tell us to pray and fast and do this and do that? I said, yes. I used to tell you to do it, but I never done it. And I used to tell you not to do it, but I used to do it. كبر مقتا عند الله أن تقولوا ما لا تفعلون. شوف هذا. The most resentful thing that you say, that which you do not do. Why? Because, and subhanAllah, this is why a lot of non-Muslims are turned away from Islam. Because the message teaches something, and the people who are conveying the message are what? In another planet, in another world. There is a split between the message and the followers of the message. فَسَلْمَانْ As a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to him, the first encounter he gets with that new religion, that he ends up what? At a hand of a thief. Wearing the garment of what? A sheikh. He used to ask people to donate, and he would take the money and steal it, not to give it to the poor, to the extent that he saved 7 jars of gold and silver. And he buried them somewhere. And subhanAllah, he died, and he left it. Right before his burial, Salman went and revealed the secret, and he said, I'll show you where he buried these jars of gold and silver. They actually decided to crucify him, not to bury him. So be careful. Watch it. But subhanAllah, the next one we talk over was a righteous one. But again, when I say a righteous one, that's why I actually introduced the whole subject with this. Righteous one, that means he says what? La ilaha illallah what? Come on. The message at that time was what? La ilaha illallah what? Isa Rasulullah. Be careful, because when I say a Christian and righteous one, that means that's not what I'm talking about. That's why I started the whole thing with this. Letting you know who are the Christians and what kind of Christianity was there. He was someone who was in Tawheed. He was very righteous. He was very honest. But here is Salman right before his death, when he is in the bed of death, he begged him, please let me know where to go from here. Don't leave me alone. Just to show you that the people who follow the true religion are like strangers. Very few. He said, by Allah, I don't know anybody on Tawheed except a man in a city called Al-Mosul. Al-Mosul, I think it's Syria, in Iraq, I'm sorry. In Iraq, sahih? Al-Mosul, Iraq. So imagine from Palestine, he's going to go away. But what the story, normally the people give Salman the title, the quest for what? For the truth. Imagine, he comes all the way from Iran, from being the son of the Dahqan, the son of the mayor of the town. Well respected. He chooses to become what? A stranger, seeking the truth, wanting the truth, wanting to worship Allah the way that Allah is pleased with. Immediately he went to Mosul. As soon as he arrived, the man was ailing and sick, and he's about to die. Likewise, right before his death, please help me where to go. Don't leave me alone. I want to go in the company of someone who's because he can tell that there is a mismatch here. He said, by Allah, I don't know of anybody except a man in a city called Nasreddin. Where is Nasreddin? In Turkey. And he didn't like, American Airlines, please, can I reserve a flight from Mosul to Nasreddin? He used to drive what? Camel. Mules, donkey, that's a long distance, going through the desert. He's looking for the truth. He want to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he goes to Nasreddin likewise, subhanAllah, the man is dying. Right away he asked him, please help me. Please help me. He said, the only man I know in a place called the Amuriya. Again, I haven't really researched what Amuriya, but I think it's somewhere in between these two areas. Or in Turkey, in the south of Turkey. Or maybe in Greece, somewhere. Allah knows best. He went there. But this time he did something very interesting. He started actually working and saving money to the extent that he ended up having what? A cow and a couple of sheep, a flock of sheep. So, before this man died, so he sat next to him. Pay attention here. Pay attention here just to show you that you are following the truth that La ilaha illallah is a bounty. Don't let it go. It is the truth. It is the religion of Allah. Where should I go? He said, by Allah, I do not know anybody in the face of this earth who can help you, but I know this is the time of a messenger who will come from the offspring of Ismail, the son of Ibrahim. I want you to go there. The place is between two volcanic mountains, بين حرتين, and there are a lot of palm trees. And here is the description of this man. He does not accept sadaqah, he accepts a gift, and there is a stamp of messengership, prophethood between his two shoulders. Look at this. Ya ikhwadadak, al-rasool al-nabi al-ummi. The description of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was told in the Torah. Look at this. الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الرَّسُولَ النَّبِيَّ الْأُمِّيَّ الَّذِي يَجِدُونَهُ مَكْتُوبًا عِنْدَهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاةِ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ. Written. Not only الرَّسُولَ, they you. أصحاب النبي. يعني, how in the world أصحاب the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would arrive to these countries, and all of a sudden the whole country becomes Muslims? You know why? Because they looked the way that the Torah described them in the Injil. Allah described the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Look at this. محمد رسول الله. Look at the last verse in Surah Al-Fatih. محمد رسول الله والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم تراهم ركعا سجدا يبتغون فضلا من الله ورضوانا. Look at this. سيماهم في وجوههم من أثر السجود ذلك مثلهم في التوراة. Allah told them in the Torah that companions of Muhammad will have that look of sujood in their faces. That's why, oh, these are the guys that we will, oh, shadu la ilaha illallah, shadu Muhammad Rasulullah. But why now look at the Muslims? MashaAllah, he's having the muhajoon, something like that. Muslim, our Muslim youth right now. What was the name of that? Muhaq. He's having the muhaq, and his pants are coming down from behind. فين يا رجل محمد رسول الله والذين معه أشداء على الكفين. He's seeing another Jackson and Baxin and Huxin. He's not seeing والذين معه. He's seeing other people. You're Muslims? Oh, really? You're like me. What is the difference between you and me? There is no difference. Subhanallah. Didn't you read the story of Umar that when they were about to hand over the keys of Bayt al-Maqdis, what did they say to Abu Ubaid? It's written in our books that we're supposed to give the keys to who? To the Amir, not to you. All that stuff is written. Imagine, he's telling him the description of the town, and guess what? I want to tell you something. The Prophet ﷺ did not know about the city he was supposed to migrate you to, but 1 year before his hijrah. He said to his companions, لَقَدْ أَرَانِ اللَّهِ, Allah made me see the city where you're supposed to migrate to, بَيْنَ حَرَّتَيْنِ ذَاتَ نَخْلٍ. 1 year before his hijrah, Medina, Yathrib. But the Jews, they have what? The news of this a long time ago. Don't you wonder why Medina had the Jews live in it? Why not in other parts of Saudi Arabia? Have you ever wondered why? Do you know where did the Jews come from originally? Where did they live before? Yemen. They used to live in Yemen. And when the dam Sad Madrid broke, and Allah destroyed the kingdom of Sheba, the kingdom of Saba, they migrated, they looked for that town where this messenger is supposed to what? To come out. And they used to kill them. Just connect all of this together. Why the Ansar was so receptive? Why the people of Yathrib were so receptive? Receptive of the Prophet ﷺ. How? During the season of Hajj, like I said, the Arabs did not abandon the Millah of Ibrahim totally. But Amr ibn Luhay introduced what? The idols and elevations. But they used to still perform Hajj. So the Prophet ﷺ used to utilize the season of Hajj. And he used to go, I am the messenger of Allah. Can you please host me? Take me to your town so I can preach the message of Allah. And you know that the camps in Mina used to be like now. You know, who's been to Hajj? The United States camp. Likewise, this is the camp of the people from Yathrib. This is the camp from the people from Tanim. So when he stopped by the camp of the people from Ansar, they looked at one another and said, by Allah, this is the messenger the Jews in our town are talking about. And you know what? Let's give him hand so he will help us against the Jews. SubhanAllah. But how Allah works, ya akhi. This is how Allah works. This is how Allah works. It gets his deen going. You need to understand this. SubhanAllah. So the point I'm trying to make here is they know the description. I don't know if I'm going overboard here, but I don't see the watch there. I think I'm doing okay with time, right? It's about 15 minutes, right? 15 minutes? You started 15 minutes, right? Yeah. But you're going to give me an extension for that story, 5 minutes, just 5 minutes. You know Safiya, one of the wives of the Prophet, she's the daughter of a Jewish tribe, a Jewish leader whose name is Huyay ibn Akhtab ibn Khaybar. What happened? Safiya narrated that story. She said, I was a little girl, and my father and my uncle used to treat me really well. I used to be that special child. You know, like when you have like multiple children, like 3, 4, 5 of them, and there is one is always what?
Favorite.
But don't be unjust and fair, but you know. So when they see Safiya, they would use what? Grab her. Huh? So when the Prophet arrived in Medina and he was at Qiba, Huyay called on his brother and he said, let's go and check this man out who's claiming to be a prophet and the people are so occupied with him. So they went. Safiya says they came back towards the end of the day and I can tell that they are so upset, so unhappy. You know, I started, you know, like when your child knows that he's special and then when you arrive home, he shows up, so you grab him and pick him. Hey, how you doing? How was your day? Good, miss you, man. You know that thing? So I came in front of them. Nobody even cared. Because they were so upset. So they went inside a room. And one of them asked the other, and he said, Ahu, ahu. Is he the one living? Qala huwa. It is. A toxin. You take an oath of this? Qala uqsim. Who? Ma anta fa'il? Wa qaribun adhu. Wallahi uharibuhu ila yawm al-din. I will fight him until the day of resurrection. ولذلك القرآن, the Quran expresses this in a very interesting way. الذين آتيناهم الكتاب يعرفونه كما يعرفون أبناءهم. Those who are given the scripture, they know Muhammad like they know their sons. Actually, one of the scholars of Tafsir did something very interesting. Really, for you to find out whether your son is your son, who can verify this? I'm sorry. Getting overboard here. Who really? You have to go and ask your wife. Come on. These days you can do other stuff. But actually, they know that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Their knowledge of that stronger than of their knowledge whether their child is their child or not. But in spite of this, they said what? No. Al-Shahid, as soon as this Christian scholar, or Muslim, I would say Muslim scholar, passed away in Amuriya, immediately Salman wanted to go to that place. So he finally found a caravan traveling to the Arabian Peninsula. Look at this now. He is willing to give up his wealth his money, just to reach the truth. So he said to them, خُذُوا بَقَرَاتِي وَغُنَيْمَاتِي, take my cow and my sheep, and please carry me to the Arabia. Carry me to the peninsula. They said, good deal, we got it. They actually took away his cow and his sheep, and they sold him in the market of slaves. They sold him as a slave in the market. But look at the qadr of Allah. Huh? Who purchases him? One of the Jewish living in the outskirts of Medina. That's why when he looked from a distance and he saw the palm trees, he said, what? Yani, there is hope. Well, Allah wanted to bring him near. The Prophet was not in the lecture yet. The Prophet is not even dead yet. All this is happening to be what? The pre-Hijrah. So, what if this Jewish individual who purchased him from the marketplace, he had a relative living in Medina, in a tribe called Bani Qurayza. So he came to visit him, and when he saw Salman, a very good slave, obedient, he liked him, and he said, can you sell him to me? Subhanallah, he purchased him, and he took him away inside Medina. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated, here's the scene. Salman was fixing a tree, yani climbing over some sort of a ladder, and he's fixing a palm tree. So his master is talking to another individual, and he said, لعن الله أبناء قتيلة. May Allah curse the children of قتيلة. You know who's قتيلة? قتيلة is the mother of Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj. But Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj, Qutayla also used to be in Yemen. A woman actually, no. And she delivered two boys, Aws and Khazraj. Look at the formula now. With the Jews, what happened to Aws and Al-Khazraj? You said it, I didn't say it. So, here it is. لعن الله أبناء قتيلة. May Allah curse the children of قتيلة. They are saying there is a prophet who came from there. As soon as Salman heard that statement, he said, like a chill went through my spine. You know when you shake, because finally he's here. You know, Subhanallah, you know, one story out of this were overwhelming. You know, and the best one when I did that story is Salman to you. Imagine it. He felt like, man, the whole thing is true. The Prophet is here, he's coming. So he decided to go and visit him at Qiba, and he took a package of deeds. And he said to him, how are you doing? I can tell that you're poor and your friends cannot provide for you, so I brought you a sadaqah. This is a sadaqah. But you want to verify still. You gotta verify. That's why when you hear somebody speak, in Missouri, you know what they write in the license plate in Missouri? Anybody knows what they write in there? Anybody been to Missouri? You guys, that's right there, Missouri. Isn't that what Midwest do? You know what they write in the license plate? Show me state. So you get these guys speaking in the pulpit, and like me. If you don't like something I said here, what is your evidence? Find a way. Shuf, Salman is teaching you what? Don't just settle. The Prophet, he went about. Remember what the man told him. What did he tell him? Listen, these are the descriptions. You're going to verify. Don't just go and say, oh, you're the Prophet, give me a hug. These days we find people coming and speaking, and Allah knows what he's saying. He bring him from the east and the west. Where did you get this stuff from? And they be, oh, mashallah, this is good. La, don't. So Rasul Sallallahu took the package of deeds from him, and he said, Jazakallahu khayra, may Allah reward you. And he gave it to whom? Lam yakul minhu. He did not eat from it. He said, hadihi wahida. This is number one. Later on, the Prophet Sallallahu migrated to his masjid. he moved from Qiba to Al-Masjid al-Nabawi. He went and he visited him, and he brought also a package of dates. And he said to him, I noticed last time you did not eat. Now, this is a gift to you. The Rasul in front of him opened and eat. This is two. That should be enough, right? No, he's looking for what? Three. Later on, the Prophet was in Baqi' al-Gharqad. He was in the place where they buried the Sahaba who passed away. And he was wearing something that exposed his shoulder, but not completely. So Salman stood by his back and he kept trying to spot that stamp. And then the Rasul did this. Are you looking for this? Are you looking for this? He said, Bala. He said, yes. And he broke in tears. That's it. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. So Rasul noticed that he's very touched. He said, Ya Rasulullah, you don't know what I went through. You don't know how long it took me to reach this. And he actually told him the story. He told him the story that I shared with you right now. The story that I shared. The Prophet was so touched by the story, he called upon his companions, come everybody. Can you please narrate that story to them? And he narrated the story to them. رضي الله عن سلمان. Salman was unable to participate in the battle of Badr and Uhud because of slavery. But as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spared him for the big one, the battle of the Alliance, when 10,000 came to vanish, make Islam vanish, wipe Islam from the face of this earth, once and for all. Subhanallah. 10,000, not even half of the dwellers of Medina. And then Salman sat with the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, when we are in Durja, when we cannot fight somebody, what we do is we dig a trench between us and them, so that they don't attack, they do not progress. Defa'ya, defensive. Rasul adopted the idea immediately, just to show you. You know, subhanAllah, regardless of your culture, regardless of your ethnic background, regardless of your tongue, you can contribute to this deen. You can. Look, the spirit right here. Rasul adopted the idea of Salman, and he divided the Muslims into two groups, the Muhajirin and the Ansar, and he gave it half to dig here, half to dig there. And then Salman stood there in the middle. Is he Muhajirin or Ansar? Because Muhajirin came from Mecca, what? Mecca to Medina. But Salman came from where? Burja. So Muhajirin said he's still Muhajirin because he migrated. But the people in Medina said, no, he's from Al-Ansar. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with that beautiful statement. He said, "What? Salman minna ahl al-bayt. Salman is from my family. He's from my family. SubhanAllah." It was just to show you that the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to give hope to his companions even in the toughest situations. When the Muslims were digging this trench, they came across a huge rock that they could not break. They kept hitting the rock, hitting it, it's not breaking, and it's stopping them from progressing. So they called upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he went there, and he said, "Give me the axe." And he hit the rock, and you know when metal and rock collide, what happens? What happened?
Sparks.
Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Allahu Akbar, futihat qusur Kisra." I can see the Muslims taking over Persia. This situation. And then another hit. He's looking at his companion. "Allahu Akbar, futihat qusur al-Sham." I can tell the Muslims taking over al-Sham. "Allahu Akbar, futihat qusur al-Yemen." So the hypocrites, they said, look at these guys, man. They cannot even fight. They are digging a trench just to be defensive. And he's saying that he's going to go in to Burjia and to... Come on, guys. guys. And then Allah revealed these beautiful verses. قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ. Allah is the one who owns the earth. He will give. And didn't this come true? Didn't the Muslims go to Persia? Didn't the Muslims go to Yemen? Didn't the Muslims take over Egypt and Syria and all the way to Constantinople? It happened or not? Right now also I'm telling you, wallahi, this deen will conquer. Wallahi, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made that statement. لَيَدْخُلَنَّ هَذَا لَيَبْلُغَنَّ هَذَا الْأَمْرُ مَا بَلَغَ اللَّيْلُ وَالنَّهَارُ. This deen will reach as far as the day and the light reach. And will enter every single home in the face of this earth. Islam. And it's in every single home. Fox News is doing a wonderful job. But this Fox is talking about it in every single home. Allahu Akbar. And just talking about it all, that's negative, but at least some people, what is that Islam thing? What is that Islam thing? You know, Islam, what is Islam? What is Islam thing? And they go and research, man, these guys really believe in God. we've been playing around for years. You know, subhanAllah, sometimes, you know, a lot of media, a lot of people can be negative, can be counterproductive. Allahu Akbar, the Muslims were saved. In closing, the essence of the story that you have the truth. The ni'mah of Islam, you have it. Keep it. Don't waste it. You know, maintain it. Enrich it with knowledge. Especially the knowledge of Tawheed, the knowledge of the Aqeel, and the knowledge of La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. Also, enrich that with actions, the obedience of Allah, and staying away from the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One last thing that you should do is help those who are seeking the truth. You know what helped Salman? Those few individuals, they guided him. You know, a lot of Muslims right now, they can be these individuals. But the problem is there is a mismatch between what they believe and the way what they act, they behave. Try to add to your Muslim name, Muslim identity, the character of a Muslim. This will help a lot of people accept Islam. A lot of people, Americans, are dead. Wallahi, ikhwa. Wallahi, they are desperate for this deen. I don't know if you heard this or not, but the year 2010, one out of each 10 Americans reported depression. Imagine in a society like this, people are depressed. Where they have the Ford Explorer and the Lexus, and the Beamer, and all these nice houses, and all these games, and all this food that we throw in the trash can, and they are depressed. Why? Because the soul is lacking the nutrition, the Islam, the deen, the knowledge of Allah. Now it's up to you, you know, up to you to help them. In closing, inshallah, alhamdulillah, I kept my promise, I'm only 1 minute. The top of my time. I really want to thank your community. I came and, you know, you made an exception for me. Alhamdulillah, you know, something about Colorado is amazing. Denver, I don't know, the people there are very receptive of Islam. They are very interested. They actually come to the masjid. They say, we want to learn. So alhamdulillah, we're having this organization called Da'wah, Gain Peace, actually. We're actually taking Dr. Sabeel in 2 weeks to come and train our you know, staff there to actually promote that. We're trying to import Gain Peace into Denver, inshallah, into that facility. And Allah reward your community, Brother Ubaid, and the administration. When I came last time and I told them, you know, Allah, we're running through some financial difficulty that we have to pay for this facility. By May 9th, we have to give $250,000 to the owner, otherwise he will foreclose on a property that we have. We're giving it as a guarantee. Alhamdulillah, we paid, wallahi, so far to $150,000, alhamdulillah. So we're down to $100,000, and the brothers allowed us to come yesterday and raise some funds. Alhamdulillah, we raised $7,000 it will help, yani, inshallah. It's yani, it will, yani, you know, it's like a drop of in the ocean, but inshallah, we still have to make night, inshallah, make dua for us, that Allah will help us to pay this man the money back. Inside this facility will be a masjid, almost 800 musalli, a hifz school, which we're going to start, inshallah, the year 2015, 2016, bi'idhnillah ta'ala, and a da'wah center. And a new concept that we should promote in America, the youth facility. Youth facility. You know, basketball, small soccer fields, small football fields, and also a small swimming pool, trying to attract the youth back. So the youth, you know, when you tell them, let's go to the masjid, you can say, come on, you can go and play. Let's come and play. And on the side, you take him up inside the masjid. We have to be creative because we're losing our youth. We're losing our youth. So I want to say jazakum Allahu khayra for your help. And if you can help, go ahead. You know, just help us, inshallah. Whatever brother Ajaz out there in the back, if you feel like you can contribute to this, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you all Jannah. You know, you can leave something for yourself in Denver, inshallah. I love you all for the sake of Allah. And jazakum Allahu khayra, brother Ubay, for the kind invitation. I enjoyed it so much. And if I don't see you again in this world, inshallah, we'll see you in Jannah, okay? We'll see one another in Jannah, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون